This story takes place in 1999, when I was a stupid 18-year-old kid with nothing better to do than cruise around at midnight. At the time, I lived in a very small town in Southern California, and the only places open after dark were the pharmacy, some fast food restaurants, and a super gross bar. So, like all kids, I made my own entertainment. I spent a lot of time driving around with friends, listening to the radio and talking. It was better than sitting around at our parents' house, I guess. But after one particularly terrifying encounter that summer, I was just fine, hanging out in our cozy little house. One night, my friend Shauna and I decided to do our usual loop around the main part of town, out behind the high school and back to our houses via the freeway. We'd been driving for about an hour and it was close to 11 p.m. when we decided to do one last loop before calling it a night. Along the way, we noticed some guys in another car. I don't remember how many there were, at least two, the driver and the passenger, but there may have been more. We first noticed them at a red light, stopped in the lane to our left. "The guy over there is checking you out," my friend said. I tried to play it cool and pretending like I was looking at the totally boring scenery. "Oh, wow, an abandoned gas station. I have to see this. Oops, caught your eye." Sure enough, the passenger of the car next to us was checking me out. I don't really remember what he looked like, but it was 1999, and this was a real white trash town. So probably like Fred Durst? Anyway, I gave him a smile, turned up our radio, and sped off as the light changed. The car stayed a normal distance behind us, and my friend kept looking over her shoulder, telling me to slow down so we could see if they were caught. I wasn't creeped out or anything. I just wasn't interested in playing flirt tag with some dudes, so I maintained my pace. By the time we got to the next light, they had gone behind me and switched lanes, so they were pulled up to the right of our car. My friend immediately glanced over. The driver gave her the "what's up" nod, and I could see their passenger leaning forward to try and look at us. Shauna gave them a little wave, and as the light changed, we took off. A few blocks later, I pulled to a stop sign, where you could either go straight or turn right. The other car, who'd been a couple of car lengths behind us and to our left, sped up to catch us at the stop sign and jerked into the right-hand turn lane. They were slightly behind our car, but we could hear them shouting hello. My friend turned to look at the driver, who was leaning out of his window, motioning for us to follow them, loudly. Nope, that wasn't gonna happen. Red light flirting was one thing, but neither of us were so desperate to meet boys that would follow them in a car late at night, especially when there was nowhere to even go. She waved goodbye and drove off, heading to the freeway entrance. In my rearview mirror, I saw their car flip around from wherever they had been heading and start to catch up with us. I got onto the freeway, hoping they wouldn't follow us, but they totally did. They stayed a few car lengths behind us, but kept switching lanes. Now, if this happened today, I'd call Highway Patrol on my cell, but back then, neither of us had one. And at this point, I wasn't certain we were in danger, but I knew something felt off. Their car continued to switch lanes behind us for a couple of miles, but didn't try to catch up. Eventually, I hit a part of the freeway that was a bit more populated, and started to calm down. "They're probably heading downtown," we said. "Or maybe to the beach. I bet they just want to try and talk to us." We cranked up the radio, decided to drive a little further, and thought we'd lost the car. But we were wrong. About 15 minutes later, we'd exited the freeway and turned around to head home. I'd been driving for a couple of minutes when I see a car pull off the shoulder of the road and start following us. At first, I thought it was a speed trap, but almost instantly I saw that it was the same car from earlier. They'd been waiting for us on the side of the road. They caught up to my car on the passenger side, and in my peripheral vision, I could see the driver gesturing angrily to us. Neither of us could tell what he was saying, but Shauna started shouting. I don't know, in response, and doing an I'm sorry gesture with her hands. I'm trying to keep my eyes on the road, but I was also like, holy fuck, what is going on here? So I kept glancing over. Then it happened. The driver pulled a gun out of his lap and tapped it on the inside of his car window at us. Shauna immediately threw her seat back, which, like, yes girl, save yourself, but thanks for giving them a clear shot at me. I looked over and saw the driver's face, which was absolutely furiously contorted with the rage. He was shouting so hard, and I remember seeing spit all over their window, which he was still tapping the gun against. I don't know what kind of gun it was. Black and dangerous looking? Anyhow, I began reviewing a mental map of the area, trying to figure out the easiest way to get to a police station. We were about 6 exits from where we started, and I knew that there was a fire station pretty close to where we are now, so I decided to floor it and try to outrun them. I quickly gained distance and pulled into their lane, which was the fast lane and closest to the exit. They were driving some kind of a Toyota sedan and I was driving a Honda, so we pulled away. I managed to clear out pretty fast. But they caught up. They pulled into the lane to my right and I could see the driver waving his arm outside the window. The passenger was flipping us off out of his window and then pulled what looked like a crowbar, waving it out of the window like a fucking war boy looking for a victory on Fury Road. I'm getting off at the next exit and I'm heading to the fire station, I told Shauna. They're basically cops, right? Or they can call the cops? And we're gonna be fine, I said, reaching over to grab her hand. She was still flat, but she was crying and shaking. Today, 20 years later, I'm the mum of a toddler, and I've still never felt the intense pressure of responsibility I felt in that moment. I had to keep us calm and safe and get us away from these guys. The next exit was approaching and they hadn't quite caught up or moved into our lane. I quickly exited the freeway, heard them pass and immediately gunned our car in the direction of the fire station, hoping all of the firemen were having a midnight party with armed police. I hadn't gone very far when I see the car tearing ass to catch up with us. All I can think is that they flipped a U-turn on the freeway and drove the wrong way to double back to the exit, because nothing else made geographic sense. I ran a red light, hoping to God a hidden cop would pull me over. But no such luck. They were about a block or so behind us. With one eye on my rearview mirror, I drove as quickly as I could, hoping they were done trying to scare us and would fall back. But instead, by the grace of God or karma or whatever you believe in, their car either hit some kind of a debris in the road or they simply lost control because they crashed into a mailbox on the sidewalk and stopped. I saw the driver get out as I was peeling away and I swear to God, I almost peed my pants with relief and gratitude. Now, before you think that the gun was probably fake, let me tell you the last part of this story. As we were driving off, we heard an actual gunshot from their direction. I didn't look back, but Shauna sat up to look and said that she saw the driver standing in front of their car, aiming his gun in our direction. I quickly turned in the direction of the fire station, and we heard another shot. I got to the fire station for the second time that night. I felt like some divine presence was watching over us. There were 3 police cruisers outside with cops standing all around talking to each other. Told you it was a small town. I pulled over, told them my story, and embarrassingly, fear vomited halfway through. The cops were so nice and immediately went to look for them. One stayed behind to get our full statements and made sure that we were okay. I will never, ever forget what she said to me. You must have done some fine outrunning tonight, and I'm glad you finished the race in one piece. Here's what I know. They did not catch those guys that night. And if they ever did, I never found out about it. They were driving a stolen car with stolen plates. We gave our statements and I kept my eye on the news for the next few months, but I never saw or heard about any similar reports. 20 years later, Shauna and I are still friends and often reminisce about that night. Neither of us has any theories about what their intent was, but I know it wasn't good. Oh, I hope I never see those guys again. I felt that I had to share this encounter, because honestly, I never thought I'd experience something like this myself. Sure, I've read all of the no sleep posts and freaked myself out, but this was different. This wasn't a scary monster or even a ghost. This was all a close call, a true story. Some quick background leading up to the night in question. I'm graduating from university tomorrow, so I was determined to get an early night. I'd gone around to my friends for a wee spliff, but don't get me wrong, I'm not a pothead. It was more of a celebration anyway, and I remembered that I had to take my mum to the hospital. Nothing serious, but she had to be taken and picked up. Then I remembered we'd rolled the joint in the car. Disaster. She'd smell and see it every time, so I made a mental note to stop and vacuum the car. We have a 24-hour petrol station really close to us, but it's sort of on its own, as in there are no houses or buildings around. I pull in and look over to the shop. They use a hatch after 12 and don't allow you inside. But I didn't need anything. It had just ticked over 4 a.m. and I had to be up at 10 a.m. So I wanted to just get this done and get out of there. The vacuum machine was behind the coal shed, but it was well lit. I cranked on some music on my phone and got to work. £1 for 4 minutes of vacuuming. Not bad, I thought. No one else was in the parking lot, except one white van. But the guy inside was yelling wildly into his phone. Not loudly, just making a lot of gestures. I felt for him. Probably some guy who's been driving all night, but hey. I cracked on with the work at hand. Then I looked over again and caught his eye. He looked away and I laughed. Love at first sight, I thought to myself. I was in an amazing mood. Then, it started to get weird. The summer sun was already starting to rise, and the street lights went out, including those illuminating the petrol station. It wasn't that dark, but it was noticeably creepier, and I was keen to really get a move on. I stared over at the van and saw the man watching me again, still talking on his phone. But then something happened that really, really freaked me out. I saw someone lean forward from the other seat and peek around the guy, then immediately slam themselves back against the seat. That's when I realized the guy on the phone was in the passenger seat and wasn't driving. I hadn't noticed it when I drove in, but I shrugged it off and set the vacuum cleaner back, ready to leave. I threw all of my stuff back into my car and went to unlock the door when a voice said, "Excuse me." I swear, I nearly shut myself there and then. My heart was absolutely pounding, but I recognized the voice. The petrol station was a Spa, the same chain of stores that I work in, and the guy who'd spoken was my old supervisor. He'd moved to the 24-hour store not too long ago. He began to shout at me for using the vacuum so late at night. The two guys in the van just sat and watched us as if waiting for him to go away. Then he said something to me that made this whole situation real. "I'm going to have to ask you to come inside." We weren't allowed to let customers in past 11, even in stores that open until 12. This is a big no-no, especially as I knew that I wasn't doing anything wrong. I allowed him to lead the way, and the moment we were in the store, he put the shutter down. He told me that he'd been watching the guys in the van, and they'd been sitting there for nearly 3 hours. Little did I know, my old supervisor saw someone get out of the back of the van, and as he described it, put a bit of masking tape across a few zeros in their number plate, effectively creating a new one. I began to panic. Looking outside, I noticed the van was gone. After checking the CCTV, it was shown that they'd sped away the minute that I was taken into the store. We called the police, and they examined what little footage there was immediately. They took the tape and thanked us for bringing it to their attention. At one point on the CCTV, the guy who got out of the back of the van turned to get back in, and it looked like he had a knife in his hand. I realize that sounds dramatic, but I cannot imagine what would have happened if my old supervisor hadn't been looking out for me. I never vacuum at 4 a.m. anymore, that's for sure. I was 11 at the time, and living in a nice suburb area. We'd recently moved into this house that my parents built, and it was our first home versus rented house in a sketchy area. And it was a very nice neighborhood. My entire family made friends quickly, with lots of neighbors, but especially the ones 3 doors down. They had a daughter my age. They also had another daughter who was 5 years younger than me, who was the same age as my sister. Our parents got along well, and we began hanging out quite a bit for barbecues at their house or parties at our house, etc. Friendships were formed quickly and seemed to be very strong. After a year or so, I started realizing things weren't what they seemed. I remember seeing police cars at their house a few times in the evenings, and when I'd asked my parents what was going on, it was always nothing. Just checking in on them type answers. I was no genius, but at 11 years old, that just didn't add up. Why didn't the cops come and check up on us? One day, I'm at their house playing and hanging out, and the daughter goes across the street to get another mutual friend, which left myself and the father alone in the house. This was really no big deal, as it had happened before. But then he approached me and just seemed off. I still don't know what made me feel this way, but I was very uncomfortable and started thinking about leaving. About 5 minutes later, he tells me he has something cool to show me. I don't remember what it was, but I think it was something to do with baseball cards, which I was very fond of. I excitedly started following him. He pulled the attic ladder down and asked me to follow him, which I did without hesitation at first. Then, something happened and I still can't process what it was. He was ahead of me on the ladder, and when he looked back to help me into the attic, there was something off. Something about his eyes, his face, his grin. It wasn't right. It looked evil. I can still see it clear as day and can't recognize exactly what it was that set my alarms off. However, whatever it was plenty, because I jumped off the ladder and ran out the door. I sprinted all the way home and was choking back tears when I busted through my front door. Mum was there when I came through and could see that I was obviously out of sorts and immediately started calming me down. As I came to my senses, I explained what happened. My mum was concerned with how scared I was, but mostly brushed it off to me being scared, young, silly, etc. Shit you not. That same exact night, I was woken up by my mum at around 3 a.m. It was my mum sitting on my bed, and as I awoke, she held me like a baby. I remember how she smelled, how tightly she held me, and I remember her tears hitting my cheek. Eventually, I saw the window to the neighbor's house surrounded by police and fire trucks. The neighbor's dad had killed himself and his daughter in the attic after a standoff with police. There is no doubt in my mind, nor in my mother's, that that would have happened to me had I made it into the attic. And I still get chills thinking about it. This encounter was, and still is, significantly creepier and more terrifying than anything else I've ever experienced so far in my life. And it still haunts my thoughts anytime I go back to the place where this occurred, and leaves me feeling afraid and skeptical of any stranger that I meet. Here it goes. To give you some information about the incident, it was on this past Earth Day. My friend and I, Des, decided that it would be fun and cliche idea to go to a local estate in our area, which we often go to, and hike, smoke some weed, go on our favorite trails, etc. This is something we do fairly often, and I've always felt safe there, and nothing has ever happened to me concerning my safety. Until fucking Earth Day. Des and I are driving around the park, which is fairly large, and there are countless numbers of trails to choose from, all with varying degrees of privacy. Some are busy, while some are practically secluded, because Des and I were planning to go smoke some of that sweet green, we clearly wanted to pick a more secluded route that day. So we decide on one of our favorite trails, one we call Nature's Eyeball, and we drive over to it and park. Once we get there, we notice there's no other cars, which is great, and everything is wonderful today. We grab all of our stuff from the car and head off on the main trail and begin our journey. The way this trail is set up is that there is a longer, wider main trail, and then at some points, the trail branches off into smaller, marked paths. Our favorite part of the trail is the part of it that looks like a nature's eyeball, hence the name. The way a river winds around a curve with an island in the middle looks like a giant eye. So we take a smaller path to get to it. At this point, we haven't seen anyone else on the path. We reason that's a good time to smoke, and so we sit down and prepare the weed. Where we're located on the path, we can still see the main trail, so we can look out and see if anyone else is coming. For a good 10 minutes or so, everything is dandy. Until I'm hitting the pipe and Des says that she sees a man getting closer on the main trail. We quickly put everything away and walk further down the path to avoid an awkward encounter with whoever this person was. After waiting a few minutes, we decide that it's safe to walk back to the main trail, as there's no sign that this man walked down the side path that we were on, and we actually decided that it would be a good idea to walk further down the main trail, something we hadn't done before, but it's Earth Day. Appreciate the sights, taking the nature, right? Fucking wrong. No. Once we get back to the main trail, we start to walk further back into the woods. Des didn't say anything to me about this at the time, but apparently there was a man sitting by some rocks where the main trail split off to the side trail. I didn't notice him, but it's very likely that it was the guy we'd spotted earlier. Either way, we're walking down the trail and I become conscious of the sound of footsteps a fair distance behind us. I looked back to see an older man walking the trail as well, and I didn't think anything of it because it's not uncommon to meet another person far back in the system, no matter how secluded the trail is. We continue walking, and I'm now aware of the fact that he's speeding up and getting closer to us while Des and I are walking at a constant pace. Still, I'm not too concerned, and off to the right of us there is a clearing that's grade A picture material. So Des asks me to take a picture of her in it, with a tree for Snapchat. I agree, and as I'm trying to get the perfect angle, the stranger walking behind us is now behind me, and he asks if I'd like for him to take a picture of the both of us instead. I'm a very shy person, so even though at this moment I'm slightly weirded out, I kindly take his offer and thank him. Keep in mind, I'm not a judgmental asshole and don't usually base judgments of people off of the way they look, but this was one creepy bastard. I'd say he was in his early late 40s, overweight, had on a trucker hat, fucking Jeffrey Dahmer glasses, creepy porn stash, and also had on a plain white t-shirt tucked into a denim dad shorts, and to wrap up the package, he had on New Balances with ankle socks. So, stranger man takes the picture, we walk back over to him, look at the photo and thank him again for doing it. Instead of walking away like we expected him to do, he stands there with us for a solid minute or so while she posts the photo and checks her messages. Now, we resume our trail walk and this guy starts to walk directly behind us. And when I say directly, I mean he was right next to me. And if I stepped to the right, I would bump into him. And I'm the one who really doesn't like their personal space interfered with. Right off the bat, the guy says, "You girls are very pretty ladies, eh?" And instantly my "something here is not right" switch flips on. I accept the compliment and politely give a thank you back. But I don't initiate any conversation. I only reply if he asks something that requires an answer. He begins to ask us questions about our lives and how old we are, where we go to school, etc. Both of us lie and say that we're older than we actually are, and that we go to the local college that's close by. Then he starts to ask more personal questions, and he asks if either of us have boyfriends. I do actually have a boyfriend, but she and I both lied and we said that we were together, and have been together for a long time. hoping that this puts him off. It actually causes the reverse. He loves this about us. In fact, he loves the gay community and has a boyfriend of his own. And at the moment, I'm not deathly afraid, but I'm quite uncomfortable and text Dez saying to make up a lie that we're heading back to go get some pizza, hopefully to lose this guy. So, when we start to talk about this imaginary plan and begin to turn around and say our goodbyes, once again thinking that this man will continue walking the trail by himself, when all of a sudden, he turns back and starts to walk with us. And this time he's walking by my side, even closer than before. From this point on, every conversation topic that he brings up is sexual in nature, or he finds a way to make a sexual comment about almost anything. Everything about this situation genuinely skeeves me out and makes me want to throw up. At one point he comments on how there is nobody out here today and how the park is secluded, that you won't believe what you could get away with out here. Every single thing coming out of his mouth is a red flag, and I want to crawl out of my skin, offer some jogger to pass us by on the trail. But we're still very far back in the woods and there's nobody around, and I think about how I could probably scream and nobody would be close enough to hear it or to come for help. The final straw was when we got on the conversation topic of Craigslist. How fitting. He mentioned how he always saw ads in the personals about people asking to meet other people in the park that we were in for sex or sexual favors. He even said that he's actually happened upon people having sex in the woods, saying how sometimes it would be a man and a man, a man, or a woman and a woman. I'm terrified out of my goddamn mind right now, and if this man had intentions of doing something bad to one of us or both of us, I was trying to remain confident and put off a vibe that I wasn't as scared shitless as I was. So I tried to make conversation and ask him what he does in that situation. If he walks past, says something, reports. And get this. This is the part that made me question my safety the most. I knew something was gonna happen without a doubt. He says, "Oh, I just watch. Trust me, it's better to just watch." He repeated it 3 times. At this point, I was thoroughly creeped out. Now, I know that I need to think fast and do whatever I can to make us appear not as vulnerable and to get us out of this situation. I text Dez and tell her to have someone call her and have them stay on the phone with her until we're safely back in her car. I also manage to slip my hand in my bag inconspicuously and grab my pocket knife, open it in the bag and pull it out and have it in my hand on the side furthest from him, where he couldn't see it. I was shaking so hard that I couldn't hold it steady. Dez apparently texts both her mum and dad and tells them what's going on, tries to get in touch with her mum to no avail. But her dad calls her, and I believe we're saved. They're talking for a long time. She manages to work into conversation the exact name of the road that we're on, and that we're walking on a trail and headed home. Everything's going smoothly until Dez's dad fucks us over completely. Keep in mind Dez's phone is broken, so she can only talk on speakerphone. Creepy stranger man can hear every word of this conversation. In the middle of talking, Dez's dad says,
"So, is the man still following you on the trail?"
Fuck. Dez hangs up immediately. Stupid move, maybe, but she did. I ask if she lost connection or something, trying to play it off, and she says yeah, the service is really spotty in the park. Then, the dude says,
"Did you tell your dad that I was following you?"
We're not back to the car yet, and by no means are safe. We make up a bullshit excuse about telling her dad about a guy we saw on the trail earlier. Half-assed, but he buys it, and we're okay for the moment. I also mention how there's a lot of kind people out there, and that I always carry my knife and my taser with me for protection. You never know what could happen. Overall, we put up a pretty good front of not being innocent, easy targets, and somehow we make it back to the trailhead where the cars are. Once we make it, we say our calm goodbyes and walk quickly to the car. I can't describe how good it felt to get in, lock the doors, and just scream. For what, you may ask? To be alive, I guess. I don't know. But I can't even begin to describe the terror of that situation. I was on edge the entire time. I never reported it, or even told my parents. My friends and boyfriend are all aware of what happened. I hope we never see that creepy guy again. I'm from the Northeast Pennsylvania area, where nothing too exciting usually happens. When I was in high school, more specifically 11th grade in 2014, there was a man who shot two police officers and killed one. After he did this, there was a search for him all around Pennsylvania and the states around, and he was on America's Most Wanted. I'm sure if you do more research you can find his name. Police around our area were sure that he was in the woods somewhere, so they made it clear for everyone not to be out too late and to lock your doors at night. One night, my friend and I were driving around our area late at night, especially because, like I said, there's nothing to do in our area. We got to a main road, and my friend starts to slow down. I was on my phone scrolling through my music playlist to pick what song to play next. I looked over to her when she slowed down, and I noticed that she was also on her phone. Since it was late at night, there was not a single person on the road, so she decided to go about 5 miles per hour and just answer the phone real quick. We continued going slowly, her talking on the phone and me on my phone, until something told us to both look up. And at the same time, we look up and we see a man, in total black from head to toe, walking on the yellow lines in the middle of the road. We didn't think anything of it really, until he walked towards our car, fast enough to catch up. We sat in silence until the man, who just looked like a black figure, reached for my friend's driver's door handle. We both screamed on top of our lungs, and my friend pressed on the gas and didn't slow down or stop until we reached the next town. A couple of weeks later, the wanted man was found right in that area. We don't know for sure if it was him, but it's highly likely that it was him.